Father, we come together today to worship and exalt the King of Glory. We pray that you would move among us in every heart, Lord. We pray that you will speak and we will answer, Lord, hear my. Father, we ask that you would touch those who have afflictions and infirmities. We pray for your healing touch. And of course, those who are grieving, we pray that you will comfort. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Thank you.
tables. We have a guest book. If you'd be willing to sign it, we'd be happy to learn about your meeting here. And after the service, we're in the room right across the hall. If you want to meet some folks, get some delicious coffee and cookies and other things that people provide, you're invited to do that. A couple of announcements to highlight is the wonderful, beautiful flowers were donated by Carol Strong in memory of her loved ones. Tonight, of course, is the Chapel Christmas dinner at 5:00. You see Jeanette Tampa in the yellow sweater up front. There was somebody whose circumstances changed, and there's a couple of positions left. Some of you have a last-minute opportunity or decision. You want to make that dinner tonight at 5 o'clock. See Jeanette Tampa after the service at the table in the hallway, and there's a couple of slots available to do that. So Merry Christmas, huh? What does that mean to a lot of people? I was born, I'm one of the rare items you find around here these days. I'm a native Californian, born in Stockton, and lived there until I was 16 before I moved to San Jose to live with my dad and stepmom. Lived in the east side of Stockton, which is the poverty zone back in that time. I'm not complaining. There were no sidewalks on the streets, there were drainage ditches. But one thing about that, street after street after street after street, you could walk at Christmas time. And with one or two exceptions, every home was brilliantly decorated for Christmas. I don't know where they got the money for it, but they managed to squeeze it up. And so they come to San Jose, 1963, pretty much mostly decorated everywhere. Moved to the Villages in 1995, the house I live on here in the Villages, like kind of on a corner where it goes around. In both directions, you could look at Christmas time, and most everything was decorated. Now it's almost blackness and darkness. What a change. Of course, Christmas lights and decorations, sadly, are not an indication of spiritual connection and maturity, but it was nice to see, and the change in it demonstrates some change, and it reminds me. When I was at Family Bible Church on the board, I had the privilege of gaining a lot of friendship with the pastor's father, Bill Scott. Him and his whole family had been in ministry for a lifetime. He used to come downtown when we were at the courts were in work and we would go to lunch. And we had lunch one day, and it was Christmas season. And I don't remember this, my old age and gray hair, I don't remember the specifics of everything it was said, but the conversation went to commenting on. He was saddened by the commercialization of Christmas and all that that implies, the things that leave the Lord out. And I just had had the thought then, and I shared it with him, and I still believe it today, but I said, you know, I understand that. We all feel the same way about that in the church. But you know, it seems to me that in spite of all that, this time of the year, with that going on, we have a greater opportunity that's given to many of us to tell somebody about Jesus. I think they're more open now than at almost any other time during the year. Everybody talks about the Christmas spirit. Well, the real Christmas spirit resides in the church. But even outside of the church, people have that feeling of camaraderie and they're looking forward to the family gatherings and all of those things. So maybe some of us will have an opportunity to do that. He said he hadn't really thought about it that way, but he came to believe that. I still believe that today. And then another pastor friend I had the pleasure of spending time with, it's not exactly the same topic, information, but it kind of is. His name was Jerry Fetzman, and he was the most spiritually connected man I think I've ever come as a pastor. We were playing golf at probably San Jose Muni. And we were linked up with a third man that neither one of us knew. But Jerry was pulling his golf cart along. He kept lagging behind. I couldn't understand why he was going so slow because he had a good shot. But come to find out, he prayed. Here's the only man I know that between golf shots is praying for everybody, everything in the world while he's walking the golf course. But our friend that we got linked up with that we never met was a really bad golfer. And he made a lot of bomb shots. And when he did, what came out of his mouth was, "Jesus Christ." And this had happened a handful of times already. And Jerry didn't say anything to me, but he walked over to this gentleman and he put his hand on his shoulder. And he said, "Can I ask something of you?" He said, "The Lord Jesus is my God and my Savior. And when you use his name like that, it hurts on my heart." And that man apologized and he stopped. And we had good talks afterwards. That's the kind of man that Jerry was. I've never forgotten that. And, you know, the Bible says we should be ready to give an answer for the hope that we have in us when we're asked. Did you know that there are the Ten Commandments for Christmas? I took this out of my Sword of the Lord scrapbook and modernized a couple of the words. Thou shalt not leave Christ out of Christmas. You should not value your gifts by their cost, for many shall signify a love that is more blessed and beautiful than silver and gold. Thou shalt give thyself with thy gifts, thy love, thy fellowship, and loyalty. Thou shalt not let Santa Claus take the place of Christ, lest Christmas become a fairy tale rather than the sublime reality of the spiritual realm. Thou shalt not burden thy servants, the salesperson, the mail carrier, or others who serve. Thou shalt not neglect thy church. Its Christmas services are to help you realize the spiritual and profound truth of Christmas. Thou shalt not neglect the needy. Let your abundance be shared with those who may otherwise go hungry or be cold. Thou shalt be as a little child. Christmas is the day of Christ's child. Not until you become in spirit as a little child can you enter the kingdom of heaven. Thou shalt prepare thy soul for Christmas. Many spend a lot of time and money on gifts and food, a little time in preparing their souls for worship. And the tenth one, thou shalt give thy heart to Christ. Let your Christmas list have Christ at the top with your heart as the gift. I remember this hymn that a lot of us sang in our earlier years, part of it. He left the splendor of heaven, knowing his destiny was the lonely hill of Golgotha, then laid down his life for me. And if that isn't love, then the ocean is dry, there's no stars in the sky, and little sparrows can't fly. Yes, if that isn't love, then heaven's a myth. There's no feeling like this, if that isn't love. Please bow your heads in prayer. Precious Lord and Savior, eternal God, our Father, we thank you so much that you have come to fulfill your promise to redeem us. You are much more than the reason for the season. You are the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. Everything was created by you and for you, and they're letting us help together by the word of your power. We praise and thank you for the blessings you bestowed on all of us. And Father, conversely, for those that are hurting and suffering, even during this special time, we pray that you will give your comfort and healing and spread your joy throughout. We ask this in Jesus' exalted name. Amen.
Amen.
Well, now we have the lighting of the candles.
Today, we light the second Advent candle. The candle of the angels. It was the angels who delivered the good news of the birth of the Messiah to Mary, then to Joseph, and finally to the shepherds who were watching their sheep. As far as they knew, this would be another normal night in the hills. It wasn't. They were suddenly frightened by an angel who announced the birth of Christ the Lord. They even told the shepherds the location where the child had been born, in a manger. Soon, a large host appeared with the angel, and together from the sky, they praised God.
Our Christmas scripture I'm reading today is from Luke 2, verses 13 and 14. Suddenly, a great company of the heavenly host appeared with the angel, praising God, and saying, "Glory to God in the highest heaven, and on earth, peace to those on whom his favor rests." So please join us now in the, it's in your bulletin, the congregation candlelight prayer. Lord, help us to see your light and children as we use the opportunities to tell us as an angel's message. And because we have received this message, may we be thankful and take time out to praise you and to share the good news the angels have sent us. Amen.
Please rise as you're able.
didn't have to show up, but because you did, I trust and believe that God will speak into your life and give you a word that you can hold on to. A lot of times people gather together, but there is no fruit in the gathering. When we gather in the name that is above every name spoken among men and angels, the name of Jesus. And God wants relationship with his children. And it's up to you to open your heart to him, to receive him, and to be blessed by him. He is in the blessing business, and he wants to bless you beyond measure. Let us pray. Father God, we are so grateful for this gathering of brothers and sisters in the body of Christ. We thank you, Lord, that you love us with a love that we can't even begin to comprehend. But Father, we ask that you would continue to go before us and cause us to stop and pause and give thanks and honor to you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Hope you enjoy the Spirit of the Lord this day. Let us sing together.
Thank you.
that you would bless this offering and may it be used for the furtherance of your kingdom. Bless those who have given out of their abundance and those out of their need. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
You may be seated.
Thank you.
sounding very angelic is because of Christmas, or you trying to get more excitement generated so that you can come and people can come to the cantata? Is that it? I know that, and also Catherine, of course, we couldn't do what we do without Catherine's musical abilities and leadership. We are so grateful that God has blessed us with people who love Him, people who don't mind serving and giving themselves for ministry and for the edification of the body of Christ. We benefit from them and their gifts and talents. And there are so many people here who have gifts and talents and abilities that are deprived of us. But one day, I'm sure you will exercise your gift and ability, and many of us will be blessed. Last week, I was talking to you about the mystery of His coming. And I had this thought, and I was thinking about this. You know, they were looking for the Messiah. It was in the scrolls. It was in the books. It was in the Old Testament. It was in the prophets. And they told people that there was going to come a Messiah. And I am sure that, kind of like newlyweds, you know, who marry virgins, amen, because it says that a virgin would bear the son, correct? Yeah. But this birth would be different because he would be conceived by the Holy Spirit. But I'm sure there were parents who had newborn children, new male children, who looked at their child and wondered, is this the one? Maybe the child had a little twinkle in his eye or something different about him as opposed to the other children, that they wonder if this was the one. I am so grateful that we can live with expectation. Any member in the body of Christ lives with expectation, and that expectation is the coming of the Lord Jesus Christ. Not as a child, but as our Savior, Lord, and King. I want to speak to you for a few minutes in Luke, the second chapter, verse 8 through 14, for a few moments. And you can follow me. I'm going to go verse by verse. I'm not going to read all of the verses, but I'm going to take each verse and impart to you some knowledge and some wisdom and hopefully some new insights. Amen?
Amen.
Verse 8, now there were in the same country, right where the birth of Jesus Christ, in the same country, shepherds living out in the fields, keeping watch over their flock by night. They had to live among sheep. Have you ever been around sheep? How do they smell? Not very inviting. And another thing about sheep is that you have to shave them every so often, because if they are out in the rain, have you ever had a wool suit or a wool coat that had gotten drenched in the rain? It weighs you down. And so the shepherd had to make sure that he protected his sheep as much as he could. Shepherds were committed to caring for their flock, and that means leading them to green pastures while protecting them from predators. And they had to be vigilant. They just couldn't lay down on the job. They had to watch. In the Bible, the younger male child of a family would be given the job of caring for the livestock, for the sheep, or goats, or whatever livestock they had, that was given to the young child. When David was anointed as king in 1 Samuel 16, 1 through 13, by the prophet Samuel, he was called from shepherding of his father's sheep. He was going to be the shepherd of Israel. God was going to anoint him, and he did anoint him to be the shepherd of Israel. Shepherds would have to be aware of the changes in the weather conditions and places that provided water and shelter. Shepherds may have a couple of dogs to keep the sheep from wandering off. How many of you have had children that wandered off? When my son was a little lad, we'd go shopping, Gloria and I, and he would wander off. And we were walking around the store, Jared, where are you? Where are you? And he's hiding up under the clothes, you know, as a game. And so the scripture says we are like sheep who do what? Wander off the path. And so the shepherd has the responsibility to make sure that they are in the sheepfold, that they are gathered, they are coming together and working together. The shepherd looks for pools of water or provides some quiet place where they may quench their thirst. In dry times, streams and ponds may dry up, but the shepherds must look for wells in order to restore their sheep. And David inscribed the 23rd Psalm, "The Lord is my shepherd." He was a shepherd boy. And he observed the sheep, and he would meditate and think of the Lord and the Lord's goodness. You know, there was a lot of time that shepherds had at night, because the sheep would go and settle down. And they had to stay away and make sure that there was no predators coming in to the sheepfold to take any of the master sheep. Or sometimes these sheep could have been for the priest. They could have been for sacrifice. But they had to watch and look for them. Verse number 9, and it says, "And behold, the angel of the Lord stood before them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were greatly afraid." How many of you are fisher persons? I won't just make it a general statement of fishermen, but fisher persons. Is that good? Is that politically correct? How many of you love to fish? Okay. Now, the perfect time for catfishing is at night. And you would go to the pond or the stream or wherever you found that there were catfish. And it would be dark, and you would put a little bell on your rod and on your reel, on the line, so that if you got a bite, if you had dozed off, you'd hear the bell ring, and you would run and reel it in. And sometimes in the night, it's quiet. The city sleeps. And you hear things that you don't normally hear because of the rush and the people running to and from. So it's quiet. And I can just imagine that these shepherds were in a place where it was quiet. And they perhaps were thinking about certain things. Maybe they were thinking about what their responsibility was for the next day. And all of a sudden, the angel was sent and arrived in their presence. Now, the angel wasn't sent to the elders. Imagine that. Yeah. The godly men. The people that worship God, the people that provide services. He didn't go to the king. He didn't go to those who were in the synagogue. He didn't go to the religious leaders. He came to broken people. Hello. He came to poor shepherd men and presented the message. all of a sudden the angels appeared, and they were frightened to death. Can you imagine, you know, out in the night? Maybe it was a dark night. Maybe there was no moonlight, but just the light of the stars. And all of a sudden, from heaven, appears in your presence a great angel. My goodness. If there was no running water, probably water would start to run. Some of you don't get my hand. But they were frightened, probably to death, because they had not seen or experienced any such event that occurred while they were watching their sheep at night. They were awakened, keeping watch with their flock to secure them from the thieves and beasts of prey. They had to be vigilant because the animals of prey come out at night. I would imagine that while the shepherds were there, before the angel appeared, can you hear anything? The crickets probably stopped cricketing or rubbing their legs together. That's how they make the sound. And the frogs probably stopped croaking. Just imagine, all of a sudden silence in preparation of the angel's appearance. And they were overwhelmed. The angel showed up. And the angel said that he brings great news. They were considered unreliable, shepherds were, because, you know, they would somehow claim other people's sheep. You know, well, this is my sheep. They wandered into my fold, so these are mine. They would claim each other's sheep. So they were considered unreliable. And the judicial system did not allow the shepherds to be in a position of bringing a testimony. They were kind of the low level of people in society. They were considered unreliable. They had practiced, as I said, claiming other people's sheep. I can imagine the silence that occurred before this great event. A visitor from heaven, the other realm. They only probably heard about angels. They only probably heard the story of when angels came. It was for a message, and the message was not a good message when angels came. Maybe it was to pronounce judgment. So they were afraid, and the angels said to them, what did he say? Told them not to be afraid. Told them not to be afraid. And out of the things that they had witnessed that night, of this magnitude, had never happened. They had never experienced this, a visitor from heaven, from the realm beyond. And the angel told them not to be afraid. Verse 10, then the angel said to them, do not be afraid, for behold, I bring you good tidings, good news. I bring you a good word. Every now and then, we need a good word from beyond. We need a word from God. I don't know if you have difficulties these days. I don't know if you have situations and problems that you can't solve. And you try to reason it out. You try to bring some conclusion to it. And all you need is, Lord, I just need a word from you. I need to know that I'm in the right place, that I'm doing the right thing, that I am following you by faith. I need a word from the Lord. How many of you would like to have a word from the Lord today? Amen. All of us, we need a word from God. The angels represented the glory beyond the world that man was accustomed to see. atmosphere around them with the light of heaven, with a brilliant light. So if it was total dark, an angel radiates from the presence of God, from the glory of God. When Moses went up to get the law from God, when he came back with the commandments, people could not look upon him. And he was only able because he had his back turned. He could not face the glory of God. So in the Lord's presence, there is glory beyond comprehension. And his face shone. And they had to cover his face, to cover Moses' face, because people could not look upon his face because of the glory of God. And I can imagine that these shepherds had to kind of maybe put their hands over their eyes because of the glory of God's presence, the brilliant presence and the radiance of God's presence. They saw and heard the glory of the Lord around them, such as the night becoming as bright as day. It was an exceedingly great glory from heaven. God's presence. Do we all long to be someday in the presence of God? Do we long for that? If you didn't know, these bodies cannot enter into that glory realm. They cannot enter into the presence of God because these bodies are from the earth. These bodies have been defiled. These bodies have been conceived in sin. And God cannot live upon sin. And so we have, to be heavenward, to be heavenly, we have to have a heavenly body. And God is going to provide us a heavenly body. Amen?
Amen.
The scripture says that to be absent from this body is to be present with the Lord. And in order for us to be in his presence, we have to have a body of heaven. The angel declared that they would bring them good news and great joy to all people, and not to the people of the Jews only. This joy, this good news, would be for everyone who has been created in the image and likeness of God. This news was not just for Jews. This news was for everyone that was born among a woman that was created in the image of God. So they rejoice. Verse 11, for there is born to you this day in the city of David a Savior, who is Christ the Lord. Long awaited Messiah, which is Christ the Lord, in the city of David. Jesus is the Christ, the Messiah, the anointed one. He is the Lord, Lord of all. He is sovereign prince. Not only that, he is God incarnate in human flesh. He will be a Savior to those who long for his appearance. Savior to those only that accept him for their Lord. Now, we can have a Savior, you know, and we do have a Savior. The world has a Savior. But in order for them to be able to have the gift of salvation, they have to go through Christ. You can have a Savior, but unless you allow that Savior to come into your life, well, you are never redeemed. Redemption comes through the blood of Jesus Christ, his death, his burial, his resurrection. He paid the price for our redemption. Amen. The news was great. They couldn't help but tell the people, is this news so great today that you look for opportunities to share what Christ has done in your life? I mean, if something spectacular happened, you have no problem telling people, right? I'm a new grandfather. I'm a new grandmother. You take joy in the announcement. Christ has come to redeem us, that we might be able to be in the presence of God our Father. The news was great news. He was born in the place where it was foretold he should be born, in the city of David, and he is born to you. To the Jews, he is sent in the first place to bless you, to you shepherds through poor, though poor and looked down upon in the earth. They weren't favorable. Verse 12, and this will be the sign to you. You will find a babe wrapped in swaddling clothing, lying in a manger. Inquiring minds want to know the location. Well, where is he? How do I get there? How do I see this beautiful gift that God has given us? So the angel told them exactly where to find the baby, lying in a manger where severally, where surely never any newborn infant was laid before. He wasn't dressed up in royal robes, lying in the best house in the town, lying in state with a numerous train of attendees in luxury, but in a poor stable and in a kind of like in a feeding trough. They put straw in there and placed the baby Jesus. Verse 13, and suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of the heavenly hosts praising God. Not only did they see the angel giving an announcement, but they also saw a host of angels. My goodness. And if the water didn't flow before that, man, there was a flood of water. Because it was beyond their comprehension. How could this be? And why us? Why me? When God does something marvelous in your life, you ask, well, why me, Lord? I don't deserve this. Why me, Lord? I haven't done anything to deserve this. God chooses the weak things to confound the mighty things.
That's right.
When we are weak, what does God do? He makes us strong. He takes our weakness and brings glory to his name. When I am weak, then am I strong or strengthened in Christ Jesus. And suddenly there was a great multitude. Now, if the first encounter, just imagine, an encounter of this magnitude surely would have invoked praise from their lips. A lot of things don't register in our hearts for us to give God praise and give God honor and give God glory. A lot of things that happen to us, we don't come out and say, well, hallelujah, glory to God, praise you, Jesus. Not even a hole in one. Imagine that. And every day somebody is going out there trying to get a hole in one. And they go by my place and I hear all kinds of things. Very seldom do I hear a hallelujah, praise the Lord. So there are not a lot of things that evoke praise from us. But I'm sure these shepherds, what they experienced, evoke praise and adoration and thanksgiving to God for what they had experienced. The good news of a long-awaited Messiah had come. Verse 14, glory to God in the highest and on earth, peace and goodwill toward all men. This is what Jesus brings. He brings goodwill toward all men. He brings peace. He brings us peace. The peace that God gives is beyond our human understanding. I know people come to church suffering, in pain, but they come because in God's presence, that we are recipients of the person, Holy Spirit, we bring the presence of God with us. There are going to experience some kind of release, some kind of joy, some kind of touch from God. And we don't want people to come to church and not experience God's presence. We want people to experience God's presence. Let his good pleasure. So, Lord, if my suffering is bringing you pleasure, thank you, Lord, that I'm able to bless you and please you and exalt you and magnify you. Sometimes we don't look at suffering that way. Our bodies are vessels and conduits of the work of the Holy Spirit. We are God's instruments. God's goodwill to men and has manifested in sending his Messiah, Jesus, came to be a sin offering for all humanity to have a relationship with God the Father. How's your love life? How's your love life? Did I talk on something that, you know, was not to be touched? How's your love life? The more you love God, the more you are grateful to all that God does in your life. And the more you are able to love each other and cover each other, the more you love God. You're not going to love someone more than you love God. Because if God is love, that means the more I love God, the more I'm capable of loving others. If that be true. So if I'm in love with God, how in the world can I fall out of love? Uh-oh. Well, I love you, but now I don't. See, if God is love, that means the more I spend time in his presence, the greater my love is going to be for you and other people. Jesus says, love your enemies. How do we do that? We spend more time loving on Jesus Christ. He has given you the greatest gift. God has given you the greatest gift that has ever been given to mankind. Jesus Christ.
Amen.
And what did he do for you? He sent the Holy Spirit, another comforter, to comfort you in your time of sickness, in your time of grief, in your time of wandering. Do sheep wander?
Yeah.
He sent you a guide to lead you to the presence of God. Your application, God uses lesser vessels to share the greatest honor. God used weak things to bring glory to himself. We've been given the honor of sharing Jesus' love with others. Share your love for God with others. I can't hug you today, but you know I want to hug you. I want to affirm you. I want to affirm the Spirit of God in you to do the will of God. But I can't hug you today. I don't want you to get these germs that I have. So I may fist bump you, but just know my heart. Let us pray. Father God, we are so grateful for your everlasting love. And Father, we pray that some way, somehow, through the weakness of flesh, I pray that you communicated in a way to someone how much you love them, how much you care for them, and how much you're concerned about their eternal destiny. Father, we bless you, and we praise you, and we thank you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Oh, yes. Thank you. So, you might have heard a cantata mentioned earlier. Speaking of cantatas, there's going to be one next week. This is the one we're talking about. And it's here, and it's for our regular service. And we have these invitations for you. They are being held by ushers at the door for you. Please come. Please bring others. We'd love to get a packed house here. It would be just fantastic. And of course, it is during the regular service time. It does say 10 to 11 a.m. on the 17th, which is next Sunday. Look at this beautiful, colorful invitation. Thanks to Lucinda and others who helped make this possible. So please take some on your way out. Sound good?
Amen.
Amen. I like the way that amen was posed to us as a question today. Amen?
Amen.
There we go. Excellent. Great.
Father, may the Spirit of the living God rest upon your people, and may he use them to further the message of truth and love and grace and mercy. Father, we look forward to the day when the sky will open up, and we will see you coming. In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen. Amen.